All right, well, happy Friday, everybody. I'm Nick Slavik. I'm the proprietor of the Nick Slavik Painting and Restoration Company. I'm also the host of this show, Ask a Painter Live. It's a weekly live Facebook show where I use my 2 decades of experience as a craftsman and an entrepreneur to answer any of your questions. I won't say any more because this is a special day. I normally go into the big spiel about what this is and who it's for, but today's a very special episode. Not only am I joined by some of my favorite people in this entire industry, this is my third anniversary show. So I have been doing a weekly show for 3 years. I have never missed a week. And in the course of this show, I've done it from Canadian wilderness, a float plane dropped me off in the middle of nowhere, and I didn't miss that Friday. I've done it from an island in the Gulf of Mexico. I've done it from a frozen lake in the wilderness of northern Minnesota when I was ice fishing. Where else did I do it from? I've done it from Brazil. I've never missed a week. So this is very, like, and then just, I happen to be here in Missouri at the PDCA headquarters here, the Painting and Decorating Contractors of America. And there also happens to be a lot of awesome people here. So I've been here for 3 days. I've recorded my master's class, Modern Apprenticeship, and I've also hung out with a bunch of these guys. So I thought, why not use this time here? They're all here. Let's get on the show and let's just talk about interesting stuff. So you guys, we're going to introduce everybody, and then you can basically just ask us anything you want. I got a whole bunch of things where I'm going to be super selfish and ask these guys, but anything you guys want to know, you let us know. So the person you can't see is Muscles from Missouri, Chris Schenck, behind here. Say something, Chris, so everybody knows you're here.
Hey, guys!
Those muscles. Oh, we love Chris Schenck. So Chris is sitting in here. Steve Skodak.
Hello.
Big shot of the PDCA.
Big shot.
Your humble servant.
Executive director, right? That's your formal. Yeah.
Glad you're using all the proper titles.
Yeah. Nick LaGrasso.
SNL Painting.
SNL Painting. Nick runs a painting company that I want to be when I grow up. So he's sort of been a mentor of mine. We hang out. We got to go see job sites this week and everything else.
We did.
Art Snarzik. Art, what do you do?
Interview advisors. I'm a consultant. I help businesses with people issues.
Yeah. He's the smartest person about persons I've ever met. So it's a great thing. And we've actually been doing business while we're here. We're coming up with an innovative new way to reform my company again. After 3 years. So, and it's been daunting and exciting, and I'm fired up. And I just hope that I don't like come home and spray everybody with the fire hose when
slowly.
I get back. So yeah,
slowly.
Exactly. So it's been really fun. So we were talking about, you know, normally when you start a big meeting, you start with an opening prayer. We will not start with an opening prayer today. We will start with an opening piece of poetry. An inspirational quote from Chris Schenck, because Chris Schenck is the smartest person we know. So Chris, hit us with something interesting.
Well, hello there.
That was awesome.
My quote of the day is a quote from Nick Slavik when he said, "Art is the smartest person about persons that he knows." So that should be quotable from here on.
You know how uncomfortable compliments make me.
And the same here.
And
can
I
you
don't
go
appreciate
register that.
That.
That's right, I should.
Both Art
That's
and I
good.
Are very uncomfortable.
You don't
right
appreciate
now.
Being made uncomfortable, you don't appreciate the compliment.
The compliments make me very uncomfortable.
So you appreciate and Art the compliments, but not the
so
view
Art, Art, tell these people, like, you give me a compliment, and I say, Art, please don't do that again, and then how do you rephrase it normally?
I usually abuse you verbally.
It usually comes along with, Nick, I think you've done some good work here, but you have a long way to go.
Right.
And then I usually say, yes, thank you. I appreciate that.
I feel valid.
I feel great now. Yeah, I have hope again. Let's do this. So, okay, let's see. Chris, if any questions come across,
yep,
you let us know. We should talk about, so from day one, the PDCA, the Painting and Decorating Contractors of America, have underwritten this. In year one, I don't know why. Now, in year three, I hope I provide enough value where you guys aren't embarrassed by me. So that's sort of the hope.
It's beautiful. I remember our very first conversation about you having a show and about us taking it nationally and internationally actually happened in this very room with Chris and I talking about that. And Chris saying, hey, I got this guy. And us talking about the concept of what you were doing and that there would be a huge, huge value to the marketplace out there. And us talking about how many people's attention it would get when we started talking about the craft and making it available to people at no cost to them, for them to be able to have that kind of access and advice. And it's proven itself to be even more exceptional than we could have hoped for.
And how long have you been at the PDCA now?
3 years.
But you can still get
I've been at the PDCA 3 years. I was just gonna say, that's okay, but could you please make me less uncomfortable by couching it with some...
Okay, so my criticism would be,
yes,
you got wildly popular, and now we have to compete for your time.
Still not exactly what I'm looking for, Art.
I need something like, we have some thoughts for you on something you could improve, or, you know, we see that there's just a lot of opportunities you're not taking a hold of.
It's really cute, but I took a few notes.
Yeah, we got notes. Good. Let's talk later.
I was going to say, our whole approach has been, there's a tremendous amount of room in the industry for more resources. Mm-hmm. And the more resources that we can have available to contractors, to the painters, to people out there, the better off all of us are going to be. Our whole goal is to elevate the industry.
So me looking in to the PDCA, I joined just about the time you joined. Yep. I think my first time I got around more than one person in the PDCA was when, like, the formal changeover ceremony where, hey, there's this guy named Steve and he's taken over.
Was that the New Orleans Expo, your first one?
Yeah. I showed up and it was the first function I've ever done. You took over. So I don't have any like historical context for what this was. Outside looking in, or hindsight now over the last 3 years, which is basically, it took you about 2 years to make the changes you need so that you could make some changes. And now it seems like this year is the year where 3 years of effort are all actually turning into something, and you're releasing this upon
the industry. Yeah, it's a very exciting time.
I felt it last year.
Yeah, I mean, really, I think there's been progress.
Yeah, it's been crazy.
What I remember from the 3 years, if you have to categorize 1, 2, and 3, year one was, I think something's going to change. This is weird. Year two, this is awesome. There's young people here, there's enthusiasm, there's happiness, and year three is now sort of like, oh my God, like, they're making something. This is really cool. I know what you guys are up to this year. Whatever you're comfortable about talking about, like, actually providing for the contractors, please run down.
Yeah, we're delivering. The Trade Best Practice Series, we'll have next week, we'll be offering a sneak peek of the 15 video series. So be looking for the email on that. The series with the online curriculum and the instructional aids and all of that will be released probably the second week of July, and that'll have a learning management system attached to it where people can onboard, again, at no cost to them. So we have worship outside of membership as well.
Wow. So this is just so I can not pay my dues and still do this thing.
You could, but we
won't. I won't.
You've already paid for the year. You've already paid for the
year.
We're
in for another year. It's all
You'll see it again.
We'll see next year.
Right.
But our goal in these programs is to create a differentiation between the professional and the amateur and the hobbyist.
Yep.
Because there really are a lot of people in our industry out there who are really essentially hobbyists. They're not people who are really looking
And that's being polite. Hobbyist, you say hobbyist, I say got fired from McDonald's and can't pass a background check, so now I'm a house painter.
What's the average number of people in a paint company?
1.5,
right?
1.5.
That means a dad and his son during the summer.
310,000 people identify themselves to Bureau of Labor Statistics as owning a paint company. And so when we look at that and then look at the number of people associated, it's 1.5. When we reach out to people within our realm of influence within Paint Contractors Association, we see that average at about 18 people shop. Mm-hmm. So we certainly have the largest of the large, and we do have the smallest of the small. You know, people talk about chucking a truck, you know, the one person show who starts out. We really believe in chucking a truck.
Yes,
but there's nothing wrong with chucking a truck.
We believe in giving chucking a truck tools that helps them elevate and perform at a professional level, and that we need to show them a pathway for a career, and we need to show them how they can be as big or as small as they want, but still be delivering quality and ethical.
Do it like a real business.
Absolutely.
Yeah, because everybody, my impression, and I did this up till 3 years ago, which is everybody encounters the same problem. So I want to hire my first employee. Now I have payroll. Now you have 5 employees. Now what? Now how do you do this? We were all figuring out on our own. Yep. And biggest step is like me meeting guys like Nick in the PDCA, where he'll just take you aside and say, don't waste your time with that. Just do this. Here's what I did. Look, you can see it. And I'll share everything I have with you like that. And then the second part would be all the resources that you guys have too. And you don't have to figure out any of this on your own anymore.
Well, and our thing is, once you get, so Trade Best Practice Series designed to get somebody off the street to worksite ready.
Mm-hmm.
So they can come on a worksite and they're not They're not confused by what a paintbrush is
These
or a roller is or anything.
These are the things that business owners have been asking for the last year. I can't find any good people. When I find good people, I waste all my time trying to get them up to speed.
Yep.
This is
We standardize that through this program. And then the question becomes, once they get through that onboarding, then what? Do you turn them over to a crusty owner or a job supervisor who's too busy to really train them? No, we need apprenticeships for them.
So that's
so
the next,
we also have the apprenticeship program underway. We have the core competencies. We have a group that has had a non-union approved painting apprenticeship in place for, I want to say, 15, 20 years in California. And they gave us the program. I mean, these were paint contractor association folks out in California who had it passed, and we're modifying it and bringing it up because we have a couple of states right now that are in kind of crisis mode from a non-union apprenticeship program need, New Jersey, Colorado. So if you're going to bid on municipal jobs out there, you have to have an apprenticeship program in. And that needs to be a registered apprenticeship program.
Yeah.
Well, there really are no significant or wholesale federally registered non-union painting apprenticeships.
Yeah. I went this last year to register mine,
right.
And they were giving $8,500 per apprentice in the tech field for tech apprenticeships, medical apprenticeships, agriculture apprentice, and they said trades, we could register your apprenticeship program, but we're not giving you any funding for it because your trades are good. And humbly, in the back of this trade or this apprenticeship summit, I was like, yeah, but that's not residential. Like,
no,
90% of all the tradespeople are residential in this state, and there's no funding for that sort of apprenticeship there, you know.
And we believe it's our role as an organization to provide that standardized trade best practice entry apprenticeship, and then when they get to a journeyperson level, moving to a master painter, for us to continue to provide resources that do that. So as we do that, we also have the Association Health Plan, which we've sought a lot of help trying to get, and a lot of people have responded to. We're looking, there's a chance that July we'll be able to start underwriting in one state, and then we have some other states that'll be behind that, where we can offer group health insurance to anybody who is in our industry. And that begins to go back to the whole notion of getting our trade to, one, be recognized as a trade and not on the labor line. Because there are an awful lot of agreements where paint's in the labor and it's not in the trades.
Yeah.
And people start lifting off all the trades and they skip the finisher coating.
So in essence, what you're saying is, you know, like if my wife is a teacher in a school district, that school district can take all 1,500 people in that school district and then negotiate a price. And obviously, if you have 1,500 people of selling power, that price will be lower.
Yeah.
Right now, I'm negotiating as a one-person entity for my health insurance, and guess what happens to my rates?
They're sky high.
So what you guys are trying to do is to group all the painting people together so that you can band together and go to some healthcare, health insurance organization and say, we got X amount of painters. What's your best price?
Right, and we not only have that as banding together, but we have a mechanism. There is an association health plan is actually an entity that you can create that represents the interest of those run by those individuals. So we have to have a governing body for that is paying contractors, that are people who are really, you know, there's a lot of really bad press out there about association health plans and that they don't work and that they're underfunded.
Well, there's a lot of bad press about what my health plan is too. It stinks.
Right. So we look at that bad press and we say, what were the circumstances that led to that? Well, one, they were self-funded. Mm-hmm. So they were underfunding their own funds, and then when they had high claims. That's not what we're looking to do. What we have in underwriting right now is there are 310,000 business owners out there in our industry. 310,000 people should have an option as a group of coming together and shopping insurance together. Now that insurance plan that they purchase or that they pick could be a series of 40 choices. So it's not just we're gonna pick one plan and everybody has to be on that plan. It's we're gonna pick an underwriter, and within that underwriter we're gonna have various levels of options available to people. But I can assure them it's going to be much, much better priced than what they would have if they were a 5 or 6 person shop.
So in essence, we have what is essentially an onboarding program, and I put my company through the beta version.
Yeah.
What you call the alpha or the beta? The beta is the test version, right? Mm-hmm. Of that, mm-hmm. I put my entire company through the beta version, and it sparked so much discussion about why we do things, why we do. Even my experienced painters love this thing. So I have not even put them through all the final versions yet. So in essence, this is a thing that's free to anybody who wants it. You don't have to be a PDCA member. This is just something you guys are doing to an attempt to raise the standards of the industry.
And we're doing the same with the apprenticeship.
Yes.
You know, there won't be barriers to entry to a person coming into an apprenticeship if we have an owner in the area who's willing to do that. And we're also partnering with manufacturers. Manufacturers are the ones. The Trade Best Practice Series was underwritten by donors from PDCA, as well as Benjamin Moore's Giving More Foundation.
Yep.
I mean, they stepped in and said, yeah, this is good for the industry. And then we're talking to other industrial partners who we say, hey, we have this apprenticeship program and we'd like to launch it nationally and have it become an international standard for bringing people up to speed. And, you know, they're looking at how they can be involved with that, from offering facilities for training to getting the word out to individuals that there's a true career path in what we're doing.
So I'm a member of lots of associations and membership organizations. And in essence, what the people in charge of it scream is, Nick, we need more of your friends. Get your friends here. And then I bring my friends there, and all we do is sit through meetings where they go through the Roberts rules, we read minutes, and then everybody's putting their hands up like, well, this is stupid. Like, there's nothing here for me. For not even members, there's something here now for people. Right. This is the thing.
And even our focus as a member organization, we're really more in a subscription model these days. Mm-hmm. People are choosing to support us financially to get to deeper dives into a lot of the things that are. This program is a free resource to the public that is being underwritten by our organization,
we're overlooking the entire education section, which Chris Shank oversees. You could spend 2 hours a day in the education section of the PDCA website for 2 years and probably still not absorb every single bit of info in there.
It is so robust. There is so much in there, and for us, we're working to make it much easier to access. Mm-hmm. And easier for people to find things. That's always been the challenge, is we have so much stuff in there. The systems we've had previously have made it very difficult to find things there.
Well, then you just call Chris, right? And he does all the work for you and then sends you the
content. Yeah. Conversations.
I was going to say, we struggle to find those at times in what's going on. But we certainly see our role, and people will begin to hear more about us as PCA.
Yep.
And as you know, people said, oh, you're dropping the decorators or all of that. Well, the decorator component came when they renamed the organization last time. We've been around 135 years.
Yeah.
And we've been renamed, this would be the fourth time,
mm-hmm.
to reflect the environment that we're in today. We had a decorator in and of America. Well, we've been in Canada. We're around the world.
Yeah.
So we want it to more accurately reflect that we're the Painting Contractors Association. So you'll see PCA a lot more now.
Okay.
You'll also see our focus on being an educational organization, a standards bearer, and one that is designed. Chris and I have had some lengthy conversations of late about really the key is getting people into a room together who have the ability to challenge each other and bring it. We see those as being some of the most significant things that we can do to help the industry.
I couldn't agree more.
But that has always been in a council, chapter, a hierarchy. Well, the hierarchy was most of these organizations had that because everyone was in the Civil War.
Yeah.
And they knew about, I have my unit and my unit. Well, they didn't have Zoom. It's all command and control.
They didn't have Zoom meetings where
they
made it all moot. You had to have your local chapter because those are the only dudes who could get
together. There was no internets.
Yeah.
Right.
No World Wide Web.
A book came out years ago. Robert Putnam was Bowling Alone. And Bowling Alone was talking about the loss of civil service organizations. It talked about bowling leagues. Everybody used to be in a bowling league. Well, Dad went to the lodge. I'm sorry.
Aren't you part of a bowling league?
No, but I didn't wear my bowling shirt today.
So they talk about bowling leagues that bowling alleys were having a hard time getting people to join the leagues.
Right.
And then but they put bars in there. And
what they were saying.
Steve?
Just in St. Charles. Oh, okay. Right. But that was, yeah, and then they start seeing that people were bowling as individuals more because lifestyles were changing. And now we've seen places like VFW, the Elks, the Optimist, the Rotary, all of these, you see them in Western countries, in the US and North America, you see a steady decline in that because we have access to people. I mean, I can text you to ask you about something you're working on right now versus before we used to have to meet on Tuesday to find out what you're working on.
And bring it up during new business.
Right. Right. Yes, and you had to follow the rules because everybody was very accustomed to a military command and control. And anyone under the age of 50, we see statistically, this is churches, civic service organizations, trade associations, we just see rapid decline in that. And they say, there's a book out, Race for Relevance. You know, we have to be relevant to people. Mm-hmm. Well, being relevant is not going to a Tuesday lunch and getting in the room and there are, you know, there's eight people over the age of 70 in there who are saying, oh, thank goodness, a 30-year-old showed up.
Yeah.
And by the end of lunch, they're asking them to be the president of the
it's
chapter.
Like you're in charge of the checkbook now.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. So there's all that. And people are saying, this isn't what I want to spend my time doing. I don't want to spend my time working on
the organization,
the structure of it.
Yeah.
I want to spend my time working on the content of it. So our focus has been to move the organization into a content base where people can be involved and do that, but not have to be within the structure.
Huge
or have
changes.
To bide their time, you know?
Yeah.
Well, you didn't serve in this role and then this role and this role, so we're not going to listen to you. Well, maybe you're doing something incredibly innovative that there's either an audience for it or there's not. We need to provide that audience.
So when I originally brought that up, three years,
yeah,
and look how far the organization's come. I mean, when did we join? Like 06, 05, somewhere around there? And it was on a steady decline because it was that old council model.
Yeah.
Then this guy shows up at the first expo and he's telling about his plans like, yeah, right. 3 years, he's like flipped the ship around a lot, and it's impressive because now we have, you know, I call you the figurehead, you know what I mean? Because you have the Ask a Painter Live, and we're kind of watching you grow your business and change it and do these crazy experiments, and now you have master classes and all that stuff. So I think it's neat that it is online. We have these communities like Business Brush, and that you have your whole Brazilian movement that you started, which is amazing, and then, you know, the trade best practices, and then, you know, what
a lot's happened
about.
In the last couple
it's
years.
Really cool. I mean, it's a different feel. I mean, Expo's getting busier. We have the forums that are busy. It's just, it's been a real good 3 years based, you know, if you go back to 10, 11, it was on its way
a little
down.
Stagnant.
It and was. Even as society goes to social media, we can get together there and share our tips and videos and look at what I'm doing. I still know that the best relationships I've built have been at the expos, at those, you know, little meetings where I met somebody and became friends with them, and
people crave that face-to-face time.
Yeah.
Well, the first one he and I went to was like 05 or something like that. Year and a half in business, we go to an expo, and we're just like, these people will tell us everything.
Yeah.
Like all these wheels we're talking about reinventing. We don't have to. So, you know, I mean, and now it's even quicker because people are like, hey, I'll send you that spreadsheet. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's like not a problem. Some dude out of Jersey or California will send me a spreadsheet if I just ask for it. It's amazing how easy it is.
And it's amazing how open people are. And it's silly. This industry for the last 40 years has been silly thinking that there's secrets. Mm-hmm. We all buy the same paint. We all buy the same brushes. We have the same vans and trucks, and we think there's a secret to any of this.
I've had a tremendous amount of help from guys in town that I compete against in our organization.
The most, I mean, you take even the Gathering of Minnesota Painters. We get 40 painting contractors that we have yard signs next to each other in yards. And we sit there and still share spreadsheets with each other because our hope is that I wish I would bid against you guys. For these projects. There is, I mean, talk to Paris. He can statistically prove there's basically no competition in the Minnesota
Paris
market.
Has statistics?
No, I've heard, well, no. I think it's not his forte.
I know.
Not his forte.
I've heard he's dabbling in numbers and spreadsheets.
He's more of like a
when he's not
artist,
networking.
You know?
Right.
It's, yeah, exactly.
That's right.
So he doesn't really like math or any of that stuff, but it's, you know.
Yeah, but I hear he has an understanding of it, so
yeah,
that's
I don't cool. know, whatever, rudimentary at best. So,
he's working on it.
So anyway, let's get to some more interesting stuff.
Let's scroll through, see if we got any questions here quick.
You want me to do it for you?
Yes, if you don't mind.
Okay.
Oh, I see Dustin's got a question too.
Oh, okay. Dustin's there? Yep. So
you got to show socks.
Sockies.
Show the Dustin socks.
Dustin, free socks from Dustin.
Well, those weren't free. Dustin paid for them.
Oh, I know he did. They're okay. That's, that's why I wear them.
That's right.
Like, if you look in my closet, I was packing for this trip, and I slowly realized that as of now, the only thing I don't have as other painters' clothes is my pants. I have socks, I have shirts, I have hats, I have jackets, I have everything. People send me stuff from all over the world, and that's all that's in my closet anymore. Mm-hmm. I haven't bought a piece of clothing in like 3 years, so.
Except for your apprentices who are moving up.
I buy all them boots. Clothes, yeah. Right. I bought myself a pair, yeah.
Hopefully you wear your Slavic stuff on your own jobs.
I do actually, well, they saw me here. I had to do my video here, so I put on the overalls and my own embroidered shirt there.
Perfect.
Yeah, those are 4 or 5 years old, so, okay.
Question from Dustin Zupancic for Steve. Have you noticed an increase in international members joining?
Accessing our materials, yes, we have. Joining, when you talk about a place like Brazil where they might be making $1,000 a month, $400 might be a lot for them to swing, but we certainly see a lot more international eyes on product. And we also see a lot of traffic. We see a ton of internet traffic from Japan, from Germany, from Brazil,
yeah,
and some of these other countries. So well, certainly the Canadian is there. So well, see, Canada, we've always had Canadian traffic.
I
so
you.
Yeah,
build that wall. Those folks are right there.
Stop it. I'm not even going there.
Okay, Nick LaGrasso, best piece of advice you've ever got. Personal would be great. I will also take business.
Best piece of advice.
Art, have you got one, Art? If you have one, Steve, best piece of advice that just changed something.
Pick your battles. I mean, really, it goes through marriage, kids, and I do the same thing with business. You'll see on some of the forums, I'm always like, you just have to cut your loss at some point.
But Nick, what if you have the answer and you want other people to know your answer? Why can't you just make them understand?
I don't even understand what you just asked me.
But I'm saying you don't have to pick all the battles. If you
no.
have you're a guy who has all the
who
answers.
Who has time for that?
Yeah, but you can fix things.
I know I have all the answers, but not everyone else does. So that's fine. I just give the ones I need to, right? But
and then you also got to hang out with family, so cut your time, right?
They do know what I look like.
Yeah.
So that's good. But really, just pick your battles. I mean, it, with the wife, with the kids, and with the clients, I mean, we have very happy clients.
Yeah.
And like I said, I don't know if you've read any of the comments I put on, like, Business Brush or whatever, and it's like, it's $500. Forget about it. Move on to the next thing. It's not worth the stress and the anguish.
Yeah,
right. And especially these days with social media, bad review. I mean, that's so damaging.
Yeah.
So that's it. Just pick your battles. Don't stew in the wrong things.
It's not worth it.
It is not worth it.
Art, Steve, you guys, some piece of advice that stuck with you over the years or something you've heard or witnessed and something? Chris Shank, too. This is open to you, too. What's been good for you?
Not sure if it's piece of advice, but mantras that have helped me was just run at the pain. Pain's a nice permanent teacher, so if I'm dodging something because I think it's uncomfortable, I usually get better results if I just run at it and run through it.
You're saying like step outside your comfort zone?
Yeah.
Do first what you want to do least.
Yeah.
The stairwell.
I like that.
Get it out of the way.
Get the stairwell.
Paint the stairwell first.
That's right. You have no idea how many times you've
I'm telling you, dude.
This
right.
is, man. You do the dormers first.
That's right. You get the gables out of the way. That's right.
Start moving your way down, man. I love that.
I think Warren Buffett's the one that had said, never risk what you have for something you don't need. Mm. So I think that sometimes that's a very easy thing to do is we start saying, oh, we've had these successes, therefore we can go do all these other things. Well, Is that really the best use of your time, or is that really what you need to be doing when you have something that's so powerful or you have something that's so valuable? But if it's something you need to be doing and something that's important, I think that's a good use of your time.
Yeah. I'll let you guys think about this one, because bringing up books that you've read is kind of an odd thing, because everybody thinks they, I always kind of go around books because most business books are kind of sleazy, and you see the guy, this picture on the back, and he's got a white fedora on. You're like, all right, you don't have to do that. So a book that you've read that's a non-business book that helped you. You think about it for a second if you guys have one.
Don't need to.
Go ahead.
Outwitting the Devil by Napoleon Hill. I think it's more of a self-development book, but top five books
I've
ever read.
What would have been the one thing that you got out of that, or a summarization?
Deliberateness of purpose, to be focused. That's everything. That you get to create what you want as long as you're focused on it. And most of us are not getting it because we allow our focus to be so split into many things. But if you know what you want and you just look at that every day and you're committed to it, you're going to have it. The Devil is in Our Heads. It's a great book.
I think I actually bought that on CD per your recommendation. Hmm.
Did you read it?
I listened to it. I tried to read it and I was like, I have no idea.
You guys can chime in anytime if you've had a book that's done that. Otherwise, I'll ask another.
Dale Carnegie's How to Win Friends and Influence People.
What did you get from that?
You got to get people talking about themselves. So every time you talk to someone, you should pretend that they have a sign hanging around their neck that says, make me feel important. And you'll sell everything you want to sell.
That's a trick you play with me all the time.
No, it's not. It's not a trick, sir.
Dale Carnegie told me to do it.
Right.
No, Art, you're very good at that.
But
whether it's intentional or not, you're very good at
that. I don't know if anybody else in the room's read that book. If you haven't, it's a quick, easy read, and it's huge. I'm not a book reader, so I'm a CD listener.
Oh, yeah.
CD.
Well, that's old school, man.
Now we have to stream it, right? Yep, because CDs are for guys from the 90s.
Yeah, exactly.
That's right.
Disc books.
That's right. For 40-year-olds, we do CDs.
Those of us from the 70s and 80s,
right.
we're glad you guys
cassettes.
Did that.
Right.
Yeah.
Art, you're the people. Like, you know,
we all are, right?
I jokingly say, we do paint, he does people.
Yeah, exactly.
Right.
That's exactly it.
Yeah.
But you could never call me a people person or whatever, you know, so there is a difference, but it's no secret that I've been working with you for a long time. You helped me find my client concierge/production manager, and it was such a wild success that we've decided to try to replicate that process, but with craftspeople now, and we want to sort of reinvigorate and remake my business again in the next phase of it. And you are basically the smartest person about people that I know. Mm. And every time I talk to you, I learn something about myself and the people around me. And for those of you, Disc Profiles just came up on the Business Brush page.
I don't have mine. He's got it somewhere in a database. I'm sure I could get it from him and post it. So.
But it came up, and it was such an interesting thing that I used to think all this stuff was just, okay, this is what like corporations do when they've ran out of stuff to do. You start taking personality profiles and, ooh, it'll tell you what color you like and stuff. But I've gone so far down this and I have so much value in this stuff. The question that was posted on the Business Brush is, I'm thinking about taking a Disc profile. And I was just like, but that shouldn't even be a question. Like, it should be just like, I mean, now that I'm into it, it's like, it's such a basis of everything. And if you don't use it for anything else but learning about yourself, it's an amazing tool. Like, when after you did mine, and I think the most important part is not going online and doing one and getting the four color bar back and then trying to interpret it. You basically were the interpreter and told me everything that I needed to know about myself, and it felt like half of the weight I was carrying around on my back was sort of like lifted up. Mm-hmm. And it was like, oh, so this is just things about me.
That's right.
Not gonna, it's
but
like,
you already knew.
I'm
but
not,
didn't know.
I'm not. The biggest weight that was lifted off my back was, I'm not Nick LaGrasso. Like, I am not the life of the party. I'm not the gregarious one. I'm not like the, you know, it's like, and you don't have to be, you know, because that's not who you are. And it's like, oh, I was like forcing myself into these situations of being like, you know, the guy who always talks first or the guy who's always the life of the party. And it's like, boy, that's stupid. You know, I should not be doing that. So, yeah, it's interesting. Well, thanks.
It helped me realize the things I was bad at, because I'm just struggling with them. Some of these things are not my forte.
Yeah.
And after you get into that, you're like, oh, that's why it's like getting a root canal, because I hate that stuff.
It gives you permission. It gives you permission to not use it.
That's right.
You know, we have a lot of people in volunteer roles in our organization, and we've gone through this. You know, our organization, we're heavy into arts model, and you know, as we look at volunteers, the expectation is not the same. If somebody's serving as a chair and they're more of a back of the house person, being out glad-handing, being the face of the organization is exhausting to them.
Yeah,
totally.
If they're outgoing, then having them take care of the nitty-gritty behind how we're going to fill committees. Yeah,
they're not the spreadsheet.
They're
people.
Not the ones
That's
we
right.
want to do that with. So it helps us be okay with the person leading in their own style, as opposed to us wedging them into all leaders need to be the same.
The biggest question that comes up during this is you take your profile, Art tells you everything wrong with you, and then the next question is, okay, so now do we focus our time on the things we're bad at to try to lift those up, or do we say, these are the things we're good at, let's put all our effort into here? And that's something I talk to you about a lot. Generally, what is your advice?
There are certain things about us that are not going to change or are going to be very difficult to change. Mm-hmm. And then there are other things, like skills, that can change. So mm-hmm. it depends on the kinds of things that we're trying to develop. Should we be trying to develop a new behavioral style? I'll never act like Nick. Amen. Mm-hmm. Right? But can I have some, can I be as funny as Nick? Well, that's a skill. I'll try, but
although
I won't be as funny as Nick.
That's a tall order, though.
Jeez. It really just depends on what you're trying to develop. And yeah. I think that's where the interpretation is helpful. I think we all have taken these assessments. We get the cool report, but for me, it was somebody helping me make use of the data and say, people with your style have these issues, and people with your style get out of those problems this way. And I was like, that's helpful.
Well, the transformational thing for us in the hiring process was to sit down and think about what a successful person looks like. Instead of saying, what are their job duties? We start saying, what type of person are they? A curious person? Do they work on their own? Do they need to be in charge? Do they need to take direction well? Do they need, when you start laying all that out over a period of time, and then you come back and revisit it and narrow it down some more, eventually you pretty much have an image in your head of what qualities of a person need to do that job. And then you go out and you seek that kind of person. Mm-hmm. And when you see them, you're like, okay, that may not have been the person I thought I was needing, but they match, and you bring them in and they do exactly what it is you thought they would do. And how successful they are in that role and how successful we are managing them, because we said, well, we looked for somebody who had these characteristics.
And the biggest takeaway is stop hiring on feel. Because we all think we're geniuses when we're hiring painters. Like, I don't know, seems like a nice guy. Give him a shot.
Showed up.
Yeah, he showed up.
Shoot, give me your paperwork. You're start tomorrow.
He can hold a flat the right way up, and he's got most of his teeth. So
love it.
We're doing this.
I think you should add feel. I think that's important.
Yeah.
I've studied intuition a little bit, and intuition is just things we know. We just forgot where we learned them. So there are things. I'm afraid of clowns, but I don't remember it's because of that three-year-old party I was at, right? Mm-hmm. So I would.
Afraid of clowns?
I'm not.
Sorry. Okay.
It was an example.
I'm teasing.
Nick? Yes. I'm a little bit afraid of clowns.
Freaked out by clowns.
There was one at the bowling alley last week.
Oh, yeah. Boy.
Bring that around.
Thanks. Call back. And they hadn't hired you.
Yeah, no, they hadn't.
Wrong profile.
Where was I going with that?
I can't remember.
I think you need to use your intuition.
Yeah. Sorry. Yeah.
That's a piece of the hiring process.
Yep.
Use your intuition. Trust it a little bit, but don't make it the only thing you hire with.
Yeah. That makes sense. That's basically what we did with my production manager, was we did a blind search for people who met that personality profile, and then we spoke to them just to make sure they're not a robot, right? Mm-hmm. And then just that last little bit, and all we were doing with the feel was basically, does this confirm or deny what we've basically done scientifically up to this point?
That's right.
Yeah, which is really good. So, yes, Nick?
I was going to say, to finish up the profile thing, Art will always tell you, it's not just the profile, it's the motivator.
Yeah.
Motivators might even be bigger than the profile.
I would agree.
So I will put you on the spot a little bit. And I don't know if you have a 30-second commercial about motivators, but just kind of, not only is it your profile, the DISC, but it's the theoretical. Do you like to learn? Utilitarian? Do you like to earn? There's traditional, there's social. Can you talk about those?
Just quickly, people still are going to call my assessment the DISC assessment, but
yes.
It's unfair because I never measure DISC alone, so mm-hmm. you're always going to get more information. But what Nick's talking about are these motivators, and DISC is how we behave. It's our preference on how we interact with others. So if DISC is the how, the motivators are the why. It's our passions. It's what excites us? What do we want out of life? And this is what it looks like as we go get that. So Nick
awesome.
And I have very similar motivators. Chris and I, we're nearly brothers, but we have very different behavioral styles, and you'll see us show up differently. But we get along really well, actually all of us. Interestingly, we're motivated by the same things, we're passionate about those things, we love talking about those things. So the motivators are key to culture, because if you love what I love, then I love you, even if you act in a different DISC way than I like.
And what's most important is that people see the four color bars, and that's basically just the first thing. My report that you gave me was 70 some pages.
Yeah, and probably with an hour debrief, right?
We could have a 6 month debrief. I mean, it's gonna cost extra.
Yeah.
I have to.
Not us.
Yeah, right.
Like, I feel so guilty because every time we talk, all I want to do is just go deeper and deeper and deeper. And we've now gone, we've probably hit page 19 of my 70 page thing that he's helped me understand. So, but anyway, it is truly a life changing.
It is.
Seriously.
It truly is.
It's amazing. Yeah.
It's awesome.
Chris Shank, you got an inspirational quote, you got a bit of poetry, you got a question from the internet, you got something for us, Chris? You never disappoint.
I want to read just a couple things.
Mm-hmm.
One, Zach said Dale Carnegie is great. Zach Kinney.
Oh.
So he reads that book annually, he said.
Nice.
He
should probably read it more.
And that's about all we have, unless I'm not looking at these right.
Nope, that's good,
that's all I got for you. Continue.
Sounds good, yeah.
We have two comments.
We got, some mixed in stuff here, but yeah.
Come on, man.
Come on, let's get some more. Get some questions.
Okay, so, Art, you've talked to a lot of people in this industry. Is there any one common trait that the young business owner does based on what you know of personalities? Is there any one low-hanging piece of fruit that if you could change about these people running businesses that would just make their life easier?
Yeah, and I wish I could hammer it home, but it's mindset and self-esteem. What I see in the trades, and especially the lower trades where there's not a high bar of entry, such like painters, landscapers, instead of electricians and HVAC,
mm-hmm.
and I just don't see it in financial planning and attorneys. Painters it's a self-esteem issue. It's a self-worth issue. It's this drive to make your millions by saving 50 cents per gallon of paint. It's this thing I talk with so many owners about where they're doing a great business and they're like, it's great business for a painting company. And it's disheartening.
Oh, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Listen, nobody grew up thinking at 10 years old, I'm going to be a painting contractor.
Yeah.
Your employees didn't think that. And that's why we have to like encourage and tell them why that's important. So it's not something we aspired to, but I think it's something we can be proud of. And when we go out in the world and we get beat up by these people who want to talk us down in price, and you're only as good as this other guy with a station wagon and wrote the bid here. I mean, it's deflating,
mm-hmm.
right? And you just get beat up, and then you have these, more transient workforce who come and go and hard to hire, and you know, it's a grind, and it kind of reinforces that, like, man, I'm not sure if I'm a business owner. So I wish people believed more in themselves.
Yeah. And there is, and we're not doing this just to be martyrs because we want a challenge. I truly believe that if you play the risk and reward game, more risk in an industry like this. There's lots of variables, transient workforce, no barrier to entry. But for just effort and gumption to be able to turn that into some sort of maybe rental housing, commercial real estate, a bigger business, I don't know that there's an easier way to do this. You're not going to go work for a mutual fund and own it in 20 years. You're not going to go work at a bank and own the bank. I mean, you're only going to, like, if you ever want to create personal wealth and you don't mind putting forth a little effort, I think you could make a really good argument for what we do.
There's
a great argument for what we do.
So many cool things. You know, Nick and I were not originally going to start a painting company. I had to talk him into it.
Yeah.
What were you guys going to do?
We were going to start a restaurant. And
oh,
I was doing a lot of the I was doing a lot of the legwork trying to get the equipment and the location, and Nick says, hey, why don't you come paint this house with me? You've done it with his dad through college and all of that. And he said, come paint this house with me since you're doing all that work, and I'll flip you a few bucks. And when I did that, I was like, you can make money at this, and you don't have to work nights and weekends, and you don't have to have all that overhead and a building that just sits.
And $100,000 of equipment and all that risk.
Yeah.
And I get to take the jobs I want and leave the ones I don't. And I get to call my price and not print them on the menu. And there are so many cool things about this. We forget, you know?
Yeah. So we should never forget that we're not doing this just because we want a challenge for nothing. Like, this really is good. And especially
awesome.
When the market right now supports it, you can sort of do whatever you want with your business within reason. I mean, look at me. All I've done is human experiments for 2 years. This would not happen in 2008 and a half.
We just wish you know? Your experience more of like cloning because it's just empty out there.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
He was kidding, don't do that.
If we had the funds and the lab space. I
3M
mean,
is close.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Nick LaGrasso, you have to get rid of your current business now and start a brand new painting business. What would you do different?
I'd start with structure a lot earlier, a whole lot earlier. Maybe even have like a business plan.
What?
maybe a business plan, job descriptions. Maybe talk to a consultant first before you're trying to recreate a flying plane.
Yeah.
You know, you start your business and then a couple hundred thousand a year later, whenever you decide to make it that half a million mark, three quarters of a million, you talk to a consultant or you join PDCA and you're like, I've been doing like this the whole time.
I have been putting
so much effort 7 years ago if I would just talk to these guys first.
I will say, like, at this Gathering of Minnesota Painters thing, there is a couple in their 20s who started a painting business, and within their first year, job descriptions, they have job descriptions for wife and husband, they have job costing, they have a plan, they have an apprenticeship program. It's like, I've been doing this for 25 years. I grew up in a crappy family business, and 3 years ago I started all this stuff. Like, could you imagine if I started my own business 12 years ago, what would have happened if I would have started this 10 years ago?
You would have screwed it up.
No, of course, but I would have more data to correct it. But it's like, what, I mean, obviously, this isn't a guarantee, right? Because it still takes a lot of effort and accountability, but I would have had that many more trials and errors and data to then improve it.
Right.
And it's like, you feel so stupid after being in this industry longer than you've not, and you basically had no plan or no anything, just going for it.
I wouldn't say stupid, because maybe your needs and wants changed on what you thought. I want to say when I originally met you, you were kind of on that salon model.
Absolutely.
You and a helper out there, you know, making things gorgeous, because that's how I like to do it.
Yep.
And 36 months later, you got 20 people.
Yep.
How did that happen, Nick Slavik? You know, I mean, you were kind of defending the small, like, no, this is a craftsperson thing.
Yep.
And you're like, you know, maybe I should hire some people. So you flipped in there somewhere, right?
I flipped in there somewhere.
I wouldn't say you feel stupid. Maybe your needs changed, your want changed. Maybe your wife had a talk with you and you're like, hey, dude, you're only going to be able to do this so many years. Maybe you should have somebody that can help. So I don't know what happened.
And Nick and I have had a conversation about when you start seeing a degree of success and that something you're doing, there's an appetite for it, you start going into the whole legacy thing. You say, what do I really want my time and energy to represent at the end of all this? Was it, I was the person doing the work and I delivered great work, or I'm the person who knew how to do that and had a passion for it, could share that passion so that when I leave, there's 20, 30 other people who have that passion, and those 20, 30 other people go out and impact the rest of the world for the craft. So you're elevating that craft.
At the time where you met me, I was under the false impression, as was the entire industry, was, listen, you can either be good or you can be big. Those are your only two choices here. You can do crappy work and a lot of it, but make a lot of money with a lot of people, or you can actually make happy customers. And from meeting people, Dustin Zapancic, Chad Lyons, you, it's like, oh, you don't have to like choose. Like, you can do like world-class work, but also like employ a bunch of people, have a real business. And that's where the flip was, where I didn't forsake craft for business. It was like, oh, I'm stupid. You can do both. Or you should be able to do both.
Absolutely. You know? Yeah, I mean, I can tell you right now, we do great work at my business. Is a world class? Probably not.
Yeah.
I don't sell it. I don't need to sell world class work on everything. We're painting a couple of bedrooms. We have straight lines, keep the paint off the carpet.
Yeah.
Everybody's happy.
Yeah.
If there's, you know, we did a giant house last year. There had to be world class work. Sold it. Had to have the right guys there to do it.
Yeah.
But will all 23 of my painters be in that house? No.
But we also do a lot of powder rooms for grandma, too. Absolutely. Don't need museum quality restoration.
You don't need that. You know, a lot of people don't expect it, because you can say, well, I'm going to paint, you know, the interior of a 3,000-foot house for $6,000 or $18,000. And I'm like, whoa, what's the difference? And it's like, well,
after some point, they don't see any value in it.
If they're going to halogen light the walls, it's going to be closer to $18,000.
Yeah.
You know, so you set that up front. It's on how you sell it.
Yeah,
but what's my slogan?
Oh, the best thing ever. I it's one of the things that I've written on my whiteboard, which is B plus quality, A plus customer service would serve the entire industry better.
Happy client. But you know, it's kind of like the Domino's pizza, right?
Yeah,
it's not the best pizza in the world, but man, they'll get it there quick. If there's a problem, they follow up.
It's dependable.
It's good. It's dependable. Yep. It's going to get you there. Now, do I want to be the Domino's pizza? No, I want to be better than that. But, I mean, as long as people know what they're getting and you deliver it and you tell them when it's going to happen and if there's a problem, you answer the phone and all that stuff that those 1.5 chucking trucks have a hard time doing because they're slinging the brush and they got to come home, answer a bunch of voicemails. Hopefully they got all their emails answered. They got their bills paid. Mm-hmm. It's tough. So we've kind of found that in our city, I mean, there's a handful of guys that do what I do.
Yeah, yep.
And it's just, you know, I look at some of the bigger, like, HVAC companies that run 20 trucks. You call them, they're there the next day. If there's a problem, they come back and do it. Robert Hoffman is like a business idol of mine. You see how this guy runs his business. I want to be that guy, you know, because he makes people happy, but you don't have to dazzle everybody.
And you do realize, like, coming from the technician or the craftsman point of view, all we do is think about, if this isn't museum quality, that's all the people care about. Well, it turns out there's other things that the client cares about, like you calling them back and showing up on time, and your estimate equals the invoice at the end. There's no surprises.
Please don't get me wrong. We do great work.
Yeah.
But it's not perfect.
Yeah, but B-plus,
that's what I heard.
B-plus is great, right?
In some cases, we might roll in with an A-minus. You know,
the biggest lesson for me, and I know Chris and I had talked about it before, which is I was ready to burn my company down because on a scale of 1 to 100, I was doing a 96, give or take myself. My people were doing an 86. Turns out the clients only wanted a 71, and that's all they cared about. And I was ready to burn my company down because my people couldn't do 96. And I was like, we were still operating at a level, we were providing so much more value than my clients wanted. That, like, oh, okay, that's good perspective. And I that snapped into focus after talking to you about it.
The artist at Pixar used to say, we say on the bottom of the drawer.
Oh.
Because they talked about how much time they would spend on some graphic. Yeah. And they said, no one's ever going to notice it. We really shouldn't be doing it. It's consuming time. We could be doing something else. And the cost goes so high. So they said, we had to make an adjustment in our craft in order to be sustainable. That's it.
Well, when he and I started the business and we were in the field all the time, and it was kind of hard to relinquish any control where someone other than us is in their
absolutely.
House.
Absolutely. That's the first
thing. You're telling me, dude, that you're going to do everything I do and make these people happy. And then when you see it happen a couple times, you're like, you know, okay, this could be a thing.
This could work,
yeah. So it's just kind of evolved from there that it's really, as long as it's sold correctly up front and you have excellent customer service, that's what people are after.
It brings up a good point, and you and I, we should get together sometime and summarize, like, the 8 trials of a paint business owner. Starting from a single person. Well, but the
we're gonna boil them down.
When you start talking about, but what if I don't touch anything? That's hurdle number 2. And then we've all experienced these things. And then it's like, well, then what if you have 3 employees and you can't be on every job site? That's hurdle number 3.
That's right.
And then all of a sudden you have to have overhead. What's the first piece of overhead? Hurdle number, I mean, we should put that down into writing sometime, because every single company has experienced those things. And when they get to it, they think they have to invent some brand new way to deal with it.
Right.
Turns out there's a whole bunch of dudes here who will give you that for free.
Well, it's like a conversation Chris and I had, like, early on when you first got hired. I was like, you need to chunk it up into these transitions, and he did it, and I'm like flattered that it actually works. It's really cool. It's like, that was just an idea I had at the restaurant on lunch, but
that's
it's working,
awesome.
You know, like the 0 to whatever your breakpoints are.
Yeah.
Because you have those guys that are doing, say, 350, trying to get to 750, and they got the same problems.
Got
to
put the brush down.
Yeah, you've got to put that brush down.
They don't want to put the brush down.
Well, and you don't necessarily have to either, if that's not what you want, but if you want to,
then
you
need to hire
somebody to do that.
That's right.
Exactly.
And I'm to the point where, to the next level, I need to hire someone that does stuff I don't do. So
yeah,
that's
exactly.
My next project.
All right. Any last? We've gone over the hour. I want to make sure I'm respectful of time.
Over.
My plane's heating up on the tarmac right now. So
I thought I heard him calling.
Yeah, I already got one flight cancellation today, so I'm getting a little.
You said it was only an 8-hour drive. Don't worry about it. Just take the Enterprise car up there. We'll take it.
I've got a call with Rick. He might be watching. I'm coming, Rick.
Did I just hear that Nick was going to drive me
to
Minnesota?
No, you get to take your rental car. It's Enterprise or whatever, right? You just roll it up there and
just leave it in a field and call it.
No, leave it in Enterprise or wherever you're renting it.
It's in a ditch over in County Road 3. Go get it. Yeah, so, okay.
They'll pick
any,
you up.
Listen, it seems like I'm here a lot. I'm not here a lot, and I'm not
twice
here with you guys.
That I know of. So,
but
that's it.
I don't get a chance to be around guys like you that often. Is there anything else you want to say or do or whatever here while we have the audience? I mean, this is Chris Shank. Feel free to hit us with whatever you want. Chris is looking sleepy, Chris Shank, today. So,
was it yesterday? I know you said you took a few hours in the morning to reflect on some stuff, and I was like, cool, because I'm busy. But I also, in the text message, I was like, well, you coming through is kind of like Haley's Comet. So I really don't want to squander the opportunity. If we get to hang out, let's hang out. So,
also hit me with a little non-compliment as well. If you
I didn't?
No. No, you have to.
I have to balance
you
it?
You have to.
But the fact
that can you tell him
but
how
you know what? A little bit on the negative. But the good news is you're gone today, so I can actually get back to work.
There you go.
That was okay. Art does it better.
Art, you have a different... Can you make him feel worse for me? No.
But one nugget I'd like to give people is start taking a list of the things you hate doing, these emails you don't like answering, anything that you're procrastinating getting to. When we procrastinate, we don't just sit there and twiddle. We just find other lesser things to do.
Businessy things to do.
Well, yeah. I'm going to quit procrastinating tomorrow.
Do that.
Okay.
But keep listing. Until then, keep listing all the things you're procrastinating about. And then call a virtual admin if you're small. Have them take that list. Hire somebody. Take that list. It'll free your mind.
And I want to say the PDCA can point you in directions of consultants that can help with everything.
Yeah.
So
start with Art, though.
It's so good to see you.
Yeah, you need to know yourself first.
Oh,
no, it's been fantastic, dude. So you'll be here next week, is that? No, you won't be.
Careful what you wish for.
I know.
So, no, we will, we'll make this a regular thing, because every time I do ride-alongs with you, I get to spy on a paint company that is double my size. And that's very interesting.
And, yeah, and you really flattered me with, you're like, man, the way your guys work is awesome. I'm like, I think they could go a little quicker myself. But, you know, it's like.
But that's about yeah, we all think right. that, though. Yeah. I'm looking at my people like, you know, you guys are stuck in molasses. And I'm looking at some of your guys on these job sites. I see one guy, he's dumping out epoxy on the floor, talking to us, running back and forth with a bucket like that. I'm like, Nick's running a good ship here, man. I like this.
We do
like
try.
This. So,
you got good people. If they had good management.
That's what I'm talking about. That's it. That's it. You see that? That's the perfect
that's
example.
Awesome.
A manager.
No, he needs that kind of treatment.
That's what I need. I need. You have good people, but you could do better.
Yeah.
And that's like, I agree. I'm gonna go back. I'm gonna try so hard when I get back. I'm gonna.
I know you.
It's gonna be amazing. So.
So if somebody, if you ask somebody what they think of something, you like them, and they're like, I don't know, man. You know, like you could do a little better.
Oh, I love it when all it is criticism. Like, I can only deal with a compliment.
Just like a sadist.
When it's, yes.
Yeah, seriously.
So
what
I would love, I've never been more uncomfortable than when I give a master's class at PDCA National, and then you see the line forming towards the podium, and guys just want to say, hey, man, thank you so much. Mm-hmm. This is real, like that data and statistics, and all the while I was like, yeah, but what would you change? What could you do different? Did I speak okay? What did that data make sense? Like, what would you want to add? You know, that's all I want. I would love that queue of eight guys saying, Nick, I don't believe that statistic that you put up for Minnesota on the unemployment rate. I think we should sit down and look through the statistics and do that. And I'd be like, yes, let's do it.
Yeah.
You know, so
nice.
Yeah, we see that too on our side. Is, you know, a lot of people say, oh, we love what you're doing. Well, what I'm doing is what the whole industry is doing.
Mm-hmm.
There is not one thing that I'm doing in the organization in comparison to what our volunteers do, what our staff does, what all of our vendors and members do. And it's just everybody got on board with some of the ideas.
But every
but
ship has a captain,
happen. Right.
And you make a lot of dudes walk the plank. So
we did have a few of those.
Interesting way to say that.
Well, sometimes that's, you know, you guys always talk about that in the customer realm. I say there are times that you don't need certain customers because they just are not in the best interest of what you're doing. So you have to make those decisions, but you make those decisions for the benefit of all these people who are being mm-hmm. underserved because you're spending time on difficult people.
Yeah. Good point.
But we have a great batch, great team here, and a good set of volunteers working. So
I've heard Chris could work harder, but. Other than that, that's
never heard that.
He's not motivated the same way you are.
That's true. It's
different motivators.
Chris knows Chris's motivators and his place to those. That's right. So there you go.
Yeah. if nothing else, if Chris was horrible at his job, which he is absolutely not, if he was horrible, it would be worth it to have him here just for like, Chris, Thoreau poetry, go. And he would just recite something from the back room. Yes. Never disappoints every time. So
and don't forget and that. And we have lots of dry erase boards for him to leave his bits of wisdom around.
So, okay, everybody, thank you so much for watching. This is a huge privilege to be here. I got to do business with my best buddy Art. I got to do ride-alongs with Nick. I got to hang out with you last night, and we talked high-level stuff. We got to hang out, and I mean, this is great. I enjoy my time
here. Should you be paying us, then?
I gotta go.
All right, that's right. Then you gotta go get through TSA.
I gotta get through TSA. Right. But thank you, guys. We will do
happy
much more.
Happy 30th anniversary.
Yeah. Oh, thank you.
Right. Right. Yeah, happy 30th
anniversary. That's right. So, thank you
what
guys very much.
What number is this show?
156.
Like 52 times 3.
52 times 3. I hope I was doing the math right.
You did great.
I'm going to have to run it by Paris and see what he thinks, but we'll see. So.
That's right.
All
right,
guys. Thank you so much for watching. If you like these guys, please just get a hold of them. We're all on social media. They'll help you in any way they can, and they've helped me greatly. So thanks again. Have a good weekend, and we'll see you guys later. Thanks.